Hello, lovelies. Welcome back to the channel. I am Kristen, your local kitchen witch. And today's video is not a recipe video, but it is about food. I wanted to talk about what it means to shop, cook, and eat seasonally, why I do it, and why you should be doing it. And a little disclaimer, my dog is right by me, Fen, and she's really loud. She like coughs a lot, and she's got long claws that clack on the floor, and she drinks water, and it sounds like a tsunami, and there's gonna be some background noise, but there's nothing I can do about it, and I'm sorry. I also want to give a few tips in this video on how to eat seasonally the most effectively, depending on where you live, because location's a big factor in seasonal eating, and sometimes it's difficult to figure out how to do it. So, with all of that aside, let's get started. Cooking and eating seasonally is something that I've been half practicing for quite a few years, but in the last 2 years, I've put some more conscious effort into it and really been trying to do it as best I can. Eating seasonally is just the concept of buying and eating food that is grown and harvested in your current local season, or as close to that as possible. The idea is to eat things that haven't traveled very far to get to you, so it's directly intertwined with the like eat local or shop local movement, but I would say it's more broad and doable for many people like myself who live in a climate where there isn't a local food option all year. I live in the northwestern United States. My town has snowy, wintry conditions from October, beginning of October through April, sometimes May. So we have a very short growing season. The idea of, you know, going to the farmer's market every other day for fresh local produce, the way we often think of when we talk about shopping local, it's just not an option for me. So I'm going to go over a few ways to get around that and try to make the best of winter months. But before we talk about the how, I want to talk about the why. There are a million reasons why people like to eat seasonally, but I've kind of rounded up the most important ones. So here are just a few of my reasons. The first reason I like to eat seasonally is because of better tasting food. Obviously, I am a food nerd. I like really high quality ingredients, but I'm pretty sure good food is something that everybody likes. And eating seasonally is one of the best ways to ensure high quality, good tasting produce. If you live in a climate that gets snow and you have bought strawberries in January, then you know what I'm talking about. They taste horrible. And that's because the more out of season something is for your area, the farther away it has to be grown, and the earlier it has to be picked to account for shipping times. And those shipping costs are going to be reflected in the price you have to pay, which is my second point. Buying food in season is cheaper. Food that has to travel thousands of miles to get to you is going to be more expensive, but that's not the only thing driving costs up. Supply and demand dictates that when supply is lower than the demand, as it usually is for out-of-season produce, prices go up even more. On the flip side, when certain foods are in season, it's not unlikely that farmers are going to have a surplus, which means every once in a while you're going to get a great deal on a certain fruit or vegetable, which you can then freeze or preserve for later when it's no longer in season. The third reason I like to eat seasonally is because of nutrition. The longer a fruit or vegetable has to ripen on the plant or in the ground, the more nutritious it is. When you pick something super early to account for shipping times, you're not just losing out on flavor. When a plant is ripening or growing to its, you know, peak flavor, that's also development in nutrition. And that's not the only concern. During shipping times, those nutrients are degrading. From the second a plant is picked, or a fruit, or whatever, it starts nutritional degradation. And this happens slowly, but just through exposure to light and oxygen and warmth, you're starting to lose nutrition. Like I said, this does happen slowly, but if you want the most nutritious plant produce possible, you want to not have it waste any time in transport, especially if it's a food you don't like and you're only eating it because of the nutrition. The fourth and final reason why I eat seasonally is the environmental impact. Obviously, this is by far the most important factor in seasonal eating. It's the reason why I put conscious effort into doing this as best I can. Every mile your peppers or potatoes has to travel is more fossil fuels being burned. In an ideal world, every transportation company, every shipping company would just be running on renewable energy, but that is not the case yet. Side note, I wouldn't be like mad if we all came together and organized and put pressure on companies and politicians to make that happen, but I digress. We should be conscious of the fact that everything we consume has a carbon footprint, and our food is no exception. I understand that depending on where you live, it's not possible to be perfectly ethical all the time, depending on whether or not you can grow your own food, depending on whether or not you have space to store food, depending on whether or not you have access to seasonal produce, are all factors in how well we can possibly do. But I also believe that it is our responsibility to find out how much we can do and do all of it. As much as humanly possible, we should be putting in effort to reduce our harm on the planet. If you happen to live in a tropical climate where you do have access to farmers markets all year round, that's awesome. I'm jealous. Keep shopping at those farmers markets and just do your best to, you know, buy things that are produced as ethically and sustainably as possible. But if you live in a four-season climate or an 80% winter climate like I used to, things get a little more complicated. What we eat a lot of the year is inevitably going to be coming from somewhere else. So what can we do to eat as sustainably and seasonally in those winter months as possible? Well, some of the answers may surprise you. Maybe not. I don't know. I guess we'll find out. The first thing you can do is buy fruits and vegetables that are canned and frozen. It sounds weird, but fruits and veg that are grown for the purpose of canning and freezing, as they usually are, grown for a specific purpose, are going to be picked and processed during peak season when the vegetables and fruits are at their peak ripeness, and they're processed right away. The processing does degrade the nutritional value somewhat. I've read somewhere, I think, maybe I'm making this up, but I read somewhere that freezing can make certain nutrients more bioavailable or something. Don't quote me on that, I don't know. But regardless of the nutritional value, you're not losing all of it, and the flavor is far superior. That goes against everything we know about, you know, fresh is best and gotta get the freshest ingredients. But in the winter, if you go to the store right now, if you're in a climate like mine in January, and you go to the store and you go to the produce section and you get a tomato and you go home and you have your canned tomatoes in a can and you eat them both, the fresh tomato's gonna be nasty. It's not good. The canned tomatoes are gonna be much, much better. And it sounds weird, but it's totally true. If you want the best food, sometimes in the winter it's going to be canned. And not only that, but canned and frozen goods, because they're going to be, you know, processed during peak season regardless, it's possible for them to have been grown closer to you. It's totally possible for farms to grow and pick and process and store food right here and then transport it to this grocery store, you know, 5 blocks away. It's not a guarantee. You have to do your own hunting at your own grocery store, but look around for it because it is totally a possibility to have local produce in your canned and frozen goods sections. The second thing you can do is learn what ingredients last a long time, buy them when they're in season, and then learn to use them creatively throughout the winter. I'm not talking about frozen and canned goods here, I'm talking about shelf-stable foods without processing. Things like hard-skinned squashes and root vegetables. You know, I have a butternut squash from almost a year ago that's still perfectly good. Now, root vegetables, your potatoes, carrots, and onions and garlic, they won't last quite as long, but they can last quite a few months if kept in the right conditions. Then we have our dry goods, which are, you know, grains, flours, which is just ground up grain, and legumes. The reason why I include these dry goods is not because they're particularly in season during the winter, but because they're in season all year round. The same concepts that apply to the frozen and canned goods apply to your grains and legumes and flour. These things are in season all year round because they can be processed and dried and are shelf stable. You can buy them anytime, and it's totally possible for them to be coming from near you. But even if they're not, even if they're coming from really, really far away, I would still count them as being in season all year round because of caloric density. Caloric density and nutritional density are concepts that we usually talk about in terms of dieting, but that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about shipment. How much of a food can you fit in a shipping container? Picture a 25-pound bag of beans, how big that is. Maybe normal people can't picture that, but it's like this big. Big loaf. And the same amount of broccoli. Not only is the broccoli going to go bad quickly and not be at its nutritional peak the way the beans are, since they were picked and dried at their peak ripeness, but the amount of meals that you can get out of that 25-pound bag, the amount of meals that people can get out of a barge of beans versus a barge of broccoli, is huge. It's barely even comparable. Even when you calculate for the extra amount of fuel that it takes to haul something heavy versus something light, it still comes out to the broccoli being less environmentally friendly than the beans, even if the broccoli is coming from somewhere much closer than the beans or rice or whatever. I don't know if that makes any sense. Maybe I can explain it better down in the description. Let me know if that makes sense. The point is, there are a lot of foods that you can buy either in the fall or all year round that you can utilize during the winter, and you just gotta be creative with it. Between your kind of shelf-stable produce versus your canned and frozen produce versus your dry goods, you can combine all of those to create a pretty varied, healthy diet 90% of the time. But I wouldn't be mad if you were like, I need a fruit, I need something fresh in there. And in that case, I'm not gonna say you can't have fresh fruit and vegetables. Go to the produce section of your grocery store and look around. Everything's gonna be out of season. If you live in a place like mine right now, all of it's out of season, but it's not all created equal. The things that were in season last, the things that were in season in the fall, are potentially going to be a little bit better than the things that are completely out of season. They're gonna be more seasonal simply because these are, you know, your cool weather vegetables and fruits, your apples and carrots and broccoli and cauliflower, all your brassicas, all of those things are cool weather crops. These are things that could be grown closer to you than, say, you know, berries and stuff, warm weather crops. If I go to the store right now and buy kale, I've already checked this so I know where it comes from. It's coming from Oregon. It's coming from a farm in Oregon. But if I go to the store right now and buy strawberries, it's coming from Mexico. It's a really big difference, but it varies depending on your store, so you have to go check those things for yourself, and sometimes you just can't know. Sometimes, even if you ask, you know, the produce manager, they're not gonna know if it's not labeled. You can't always know for sure, but do your research. Learn as much about the produce and frozen goods and dry goods from your store as much as you possibly can, and make the best educated decisions you can. That's all you can do. The next point is a little redundant, but it's just simply to go without some things. It's not fun, it's not exciting, but it is for the best. Of course, this is all location dependent, and all of the examples that I've given are going to really only be applicable to people in the northern part of the northern hemisphere where I am. It's not going to apply to you everywhere, especially if you're in the southern half of the world. These things could all be flipped for you or completely different just depending on what food you have available. So take the concepts in mind rather than the examples. And the last point is just to shop discounts. this is my kind of cheat. At my grocery store, I have a discount produce rack. I know personally for my store, anything that doesn't sell off that rack just goes to a landfill. That might not be the case for your store. They might be much more responsible with their waste. Awesome if they are. But in my case, these things that are on this produce rack most of the time are totally good. They're just cosmetically damaged in some way. Sometimes they're not, so, you know, be aware, be safe, don't eat things with mold on it. But I consider this to be kind of the thrifting option for produce. If it's out of season, but it's on the discount rack, it's something that wouldn't have been a sustainable choice otherwise, but is now just saving it from going to waste. And I have one kind of bonus tip, I guess, that I'll throw in here. I'll call this a bonus because it's not possible for everyone and it doesn't make a huge difference, but you can always grow things. If you are lucky enough to have an outdoor space where you can grow your own food garden, that is amazing, and you should do that. If you don't have to have grass, don't have it. Grow some food. It's the much better choice. But most of us aren't in that situation. I am, and I'm so grateful and so lucky, but I recognize that most of you probably aren't. However, you can grow a few herbs in your windowsill, or you can grow maybe a flat of salad greens under a grow lamp. That's a little more costly, but another option is doing sprouts in a jar. The only tools you need is a mason jar, water, and seeds. And even like mung bean sprouts, you don't even need light for that. In fact, it's better to grow them in the dark. So as long as you have counter space and a jar and water and seeds, you can do sprouts. Obviously, none of these little countertop things are gonna make a huge difference in your overall diet, but they can make things feel much more fresh, especially some fresh herbs. Man, when you are in the monotony of dense, starchy foods in the winter, some fresh herbs can brighten things up and make it way more exciting and palatable. Anyway, I know how frustrating it is to care about something and to want to put an effort into it without it being really possible to do perfectly, but every effort counts. And if you are putting in an effort doing any of these things to try to eat more seasonally, then you are awesome and I am proud of you. If you have any questions about any of these concepts or any comments or suggestions for future videos, please leave those in the comments down below and I will see you in the next video.